Ladies and gentlemen, it is Monday, the 24th day of August, 2015. I'm Alex Jones, coming to you with a recorded report from Monday morning, about an hour and a half before the broadcast starts. I will be calling in live later via a connection in Chicago. David Knight will be hosting the broadcast. Again, ladies and gentlemen, we saw Asian stock markets plunge massively in their trading. Now we will have more intel as the U.S. stock market opens. Obviously, by the time you hear this report, the stock market has opened. In the futures market, the stock market was down 800 plus points in the futures market. Falling market tide is lowering all boats around the world. Oil has sunk in its price yet again, another 4%. This is massive. But regardless of all the current technicals, it's key to understand that InfoWars.com and our family of guests and researchers absolutely predicted this with precision. And it's not about the laurels that we predicted what is happening. It's about the fact that we know what the problem is and we know how to fix it. That's why we toot our horn and explain that we're the ones that expose this more accurately than anybody else. This is an orchestrated global financial consolidation, and the globalists are giving themselves the literally hundreds of trillions in different currencies by devaluing the currencies and giving themselves first use of it. They are also, through the private central banks, consolidating control, giving themselves 0% interest. They are rigging all the major markets. It's come out in the news that the stock markets are rigged, that the rates are rigged, that the entire system, the currency markets are rigged. And beyond that, they are now going to hold everyone hostage as this global financial crisis deepens. Wait for it. When the yuppies and the retirees and everybody else sees that their 401ks are massively devalued here in the next few weeks, and as the stimulus fails to work by design, as this bubble begins to implode, they're going to come in and call for a global rescue package and world emergency summits of the G20 and of central banks to offer their solution. Accelerated integration of Asia, Europe, and the Americas. Accelerated, quote, cooperation and a global stimulus emergency package of $100 trillion over the next 10 years to help finance recovery. That money will then be selectively given from one hand to the other, from one hand of the globalists to their other hand, to selectively only develop economic operations in sectors that they're in control. And then you will get jobs working for them. It's the same thing they've done in the third world over and over and over again. This formulae is known. We got the IMF World Bank documents in 2002 where they said, next, we're going to start doing this to the West. And then I told you 5 years ago, I talked to a billionaire, a major defense contractor owner, and they said, look, within 5 years, there won't be an America. And I said, what do you mean? And they said, you know what I mean. Listen to your own show. It's dead on. You're going to be very, very famous if you can basically stay alive. And you've heard all the guests. You've heard the intel. You've heard it all. We've broken it down. This is engineered, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Dent, just 2 weeks ago, said it was on. We'll be back. Stay with us, ladies and gentlemen.
China is the greatest bubble in history. It is finally coming unraveled. That's why I am confident that we are within, I'd say, weeks of the global bubble bursting again. I think the U.S. markets are going to start heading down by early September, probably peaking in the next week or two. So I think this is happening.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Jones reporting to you from the road via audio Skype. You are listening to this worldwide Monday, the 24th day of August, 2015 transmission on over 170 affiliates across the United States, WWCR, Global Shortwave, and of course the internet streams at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com, as well as TV satellites that we have already fired up that we'll be announcing the coordinates to in the next 2 weeks. We have been building towards launching the TV network during the financial collapse. I have told everyone that I plan to launch it during the beginning of the collapse. It has now happened, ladies and gentlemen, because for every action, there's an opposite and equal reaction. We are that opposite and equal reaction. Now, everyone knows that ad nauseum, we have predicted exactly what's now happening. Number one, that's not hard to do because the globalists act like we're 5 years old and write about it in their internal periodicals and in their own publications, which are available but not widely distributed. So their plan to leverage the world, create 2.2 quadrillion in derivatives, get every major government of the West to sign on to it, to hold the public hostage with too big to fail, is a public plan. Derivatives have only gotten worse since the last crisis of 2008. This crisis undoubtedly is going to massively dwarf what we saw in 2008. Now, the globalists don't even know exactly how they're going to carry this out. They know they've engineered it. They know they're going to consolidate power out of the collapse. They know they're going to call for global SDR, new global taxes to backstop the economy and create a new bubble. But once they trigger the current phase of the crisis, they're orchestrating the larger phase, the larger continuum. But when they get into a new phase of the crisis, they gauge it first, do trial balloons to decide exactly what they're going to pull. But in general, we know what's going to happen. This may be the beginning of the true mega implosion. Or they may get some more banker bailouts, steal trillions more from the different countries, consolidate the economy, create an IMF World Bank emergency slush fund, which they then give to their own pockets as, quote, a worldwide stimulus package, and then quasi-stabilize Chinese, Japanese, U.S., and European markets for another 6 months, a year, maybe 2 years. But the smart money says that's not what's happening, because the elites are running around, as we've told you, like chickens with their heads cut off. Remember 2 months ago, I shot the video headline, Total Emergency Alert. I've said emergency alert before, but never total emergency alert in 20 years on air. Total emergency alert. The elite are literally going to their bunkers, their airstrips, their Northern Canada redoubts, their Cook Island redoubts, their armored fortresses, one of the biggest houses in the world with 4-foot-thick concrete walls and huge bars on the windows with an underground base, admittedly in the Ozarks, connected to the Defense Department. I mean, there is a lot of whacked-out stuff going on, and elites are buying gold and silver like it is going, you know, to the moon. We have got armored vehicles getting delivered everywhere, Marines and Army training for civil unrest, the Pentagon admitting they're preparing for it, with George Soros trying to cause a race war triggered by attacking the police. I mean, we've got a lot of different things coming together right now. We've got forced inoculations being announced all over the world, from Australia to the U.S., from California to Australia. We've got the planets aligning. We have Al-Qaeda being turned loose worldwide to attack Christian and non-radical Muslim targets. It is unprecedented. But remember, we had Mr. Dent on 2 weeks ago. I believe it's to the day. We'll put the article up with the YouTube on screen right now. 2 weeks ago, I believe to the day, he came on and said, 2 weeks, it's a dead cat bounce. Look at the charts. And you can look at the one-year chart, the five-year chart, the month chart. You can see the dead cat bounce, and now it's headed straight down. 1,000 points last week. When trading opens up, as I'm recording this right before we go live, David Knight is going to be in studio live. I'll be calling in from a connection in Chicago. I'm recording this basically at the airport via audio Skype 2 hours before the show starts. So I'll be in the air when the show starts. I'll be landing about an hour in. And as soon as I can, I've got a 2-hour layover. After I clear customs, I will be calling in via audio Skype or video Skype from O'Hare. So we're going to be tracking all of this as it unfolds. But they may close the stock market today. They may have a bank holiday this week. Anything is possible. They may keep it open and let it go all the way down 2,000 or 3,000 points. I mean, this route could be massive. We're going to find out what happens today. I don't know if they're going to decide to buoy it or they're going to decide to let it fall. But China, basically lowering their currency, I guess yuan, I always pronounce it wrong, is the signal that they are not going to hold up the dollar anymore. And notice China is ceasing, basically cutting back to almost nothing, their purchase of U.S. Treasury notes. All of this signals what we already saw in the tea leaves building up to this. We should have collapsed a long time ago, but they artificially pumped this bubble up to where now, when the bubble goes, it is going to be ultra massive. And we see all of these paramilitary preparations. Clearly, they're looking at staging race riots during an economic collapse to act like the race riots caused the economic collapse. And they're trying to stir up the giant disenfranchised inner city populations to basically go out and start looting, and thugs of every ilk to join forces and go out and engage in criminal activity to further destroy confidence. So again, the globalists will get up on TV and talk about confidence all day and talk about buying into their bubbles all day, or they'll say you're killing confidence, when in truth, they're the ones that have created this global bubble and suck people into their confidence to defraud them. If you read the IMF World Bank documents that got leaked, it's like an owner's manual to tyranny. In 2002, it talks about once they turn the money off, once they implode an economy, once they give the green light in a country to the media that the mega banks control to say that there's a panic, they will then come out and say to everyone, oh my gosh, you know, look at this riot in the street. The police can't do anything. That will then spread. The police will be ordered to stand down like they were done in several U.S. cities this year, like Maryland, Baltimore, Maryland, and other areas. And then when that carnage spreads, it will further destroy confidence and drop the market artificially to below what it's even worth. Maybe 50%, 60%. I'm not saying that's happening today. That's the next phase. Then the globalists will come in with a police state, clean that up, and be the saviors, jack the market back up some, and then take major profits on the backs of those that were panicked. So this is how they operate. And we know, because it's called in the 100-point-plus plan, the IMF riot. The IMF World Bank calls it the IMF riot because they will then trigger and green light through their agitators, through their city organizers like Obama, Saul Alinsky techniques. This is all IMF World Bank runs. When the big foundations fund all these leftist groups, they will trigger the riots, call them racial, use a few bad apple cops as the excuse. All hell will break loose to further destroy confidence. So the next phase, and you can see this being lined up, is the IMF riot, ladies and gentlemen. And you can see they've already primed the detonators with their Black Lives Matter and other operative groups all over the United States, sucking useful idiots in for the next phase. This is an extremely critical time right now. Here's the good news. We know the game plan. And if folks will simply realize that InfoWars.com and the brain trust of people we have and researchers we have and analysis we have and focus on history that we have, that if the military and the police and the good people in the government listen to us who are compartmentalized, and if the general public will listen to us, this paradigm will fail and will fall. We have the enemy plan. They've done this not in dozens but hundreds of third world countries, sometimes over and over again in just the last 30 years. They have perfected this takeover plan. For people that aren't researched, this sounds like quantum mechanics, or it sounds like equations or something. It's not. It is a shake and bake operation where they know exactly what they're doing with a formula, just like you go to the cupboard and get the pancake mix and you add one egg or two eggs and milk, you stir it up, you put it in the pan, and you get pancakes. I mean, they are following a recipe. They are following a program. As General Benton K. Parton used to say, former head of Air Force Weapons Development, that the globalists were creating a program to implode the country incrementally, get us dependent on welfare, then have the inner cities riot, and then bring in martial law after that next phase. and they want to steal your pension funds. They want to impoverish you, but they've got to pose like the saviors so they can skim off those and federalize them so they can then transfer the wealth to the offshore banks. We'll be back after this break. I'll do one more segment. Then we'll go live to David Knight waiting in studio. This is recorded. David Knight will be live in studio at 11:33 Central Standard Time. Stay with us. Ladies and gentlemen, while we've been distracted with Jenner, while we've been distracted by the word boy and girl being hurtful and hate-filled, our water's been poisoned. Our environment's been taken over. We're living in a science fiction movie where we're eating genetically engineered food that rats get cancer when they eat it. And while we've had our future basically stolen, while a breakaway civilization has created high-tech reservations with diplomatic immunity above the law, while we've been living in the dark, while we've been sleeping, while the establishment lives, while they've been planning our world, a huge mountain of debt, more than 2.2 quadrillion, has been created. We have been signed on to it. Since the 2008 crisis, they have accelerated the exact same policies that now brought us to this point. So wait for it. Wait for the stock market bailout talk. Wait for the banker bailout talk. Wait for the city bailout talk. Wait for it. And here's how it works. The person down at the local level is told, keep the system going at all costs. The establishment wants to stabilize things. Write more tickets, take more houses, consolidate more, raise taxes. All of that actually only shuts down the economy that the globalists don't control. And so that's the bottom line here. The people that are in control of our civilization, the people that are driving the policy, have a set plan to create giant bubbles that they ride up as the insiders, that they consolidate power with, that they make fortunes that dwarf anything we've ever heard of, so they can have yachts bigger than battleships and 20 helicopters apiece and 100 mistresses, and they can be above the law. And then they tell us through their liberation theology colleges that someone driving a nice car is greedy and bad. And they sick the giant, dumbed down, unwashed masses on what's left of the middle class. This is global domination. This is the world being captured. This is economic warfare. And out of this global crisis, this is clearly the beginning of the implosion of the worldwide bubble. May not be this year, may not be next year. They may just get more power and milk more control out of this. But it's impossible to ever prop up these bubbles. And the establishment knows that and has been digging in to transfer us to a command and control economy, to a system where the insiders are, again, above the law, tax exempt, and get to keep their wealth, and everyone else is impoverished and basically has our rights stolen. If we do not get the word out that this is engineered, this is one more step towards a world government run by private central banks. They needed a global crisis to then demand a global solution of a worldwide SDR tax based on carbon credits, wellhead taxes, and money transfers. And carbon taxes and money transfers will track everything you do. And when the global government has the power to automatically debit and tax off of your digital currencies, you have a true world government with a world religion, with a world army. Notice the Pope just came out and called for a one-world government 2 months ago and carbon taxes and communism and socialism, basically, and said, if you don't open up your borders and give people stuff free, you're bad. But the Vatican is sovereign and doesn't open up its borders. He said that because they're getting ready to make the move. And notice we had the Pope here announcing that he's going to be here on the 24th of September, right in the middle of the global meltdown. So again, it's all being announced. The globalists are making their moves. This is it. This is an incredible time to be alive. I'm taping this before the stock market opens. As soon as I land in Chicago and clear customs, I'll call in the second or third hour with my analysis with David Knight. We're clearing the decks here at InfoWars. This is absolutely key, and we have the answers. We successfully predicted this by the grace of God. Thank you all. We'll be back with David Knight live in the InfoWars News Center in Austin, Texas. Again, ladies and gentlemen, this Monday, the 24th day of August 2015, is such a key day because it's when confidence is lost. And the globalists could prop up the Chinese market, they could prop up the U.S. market, they could prop up the European market. They are choosing not to do it. And we're about to go to David Knight live. And then I'll be back live as soon as I get through customs. I'm about to board a plane. But what I'm getting at here is don't have fear. We're here telling you this so you have a jump on it. It'd be like knowing if somebody was coming to rob your house, you'd be ready for them, or the police would be ready for them. We're giving everybody the jump here. We gave everybody the jump, and now we're going to give everybody the breakdown of how the globalists run this formula and how we can stop them. That's why they're always stalling us, saying there's no world government, there's no private IMF or World Bank, you know, the CFR doesn't exist. When I was first on air 20 years ago, they said the CFR didn't exist. People didn't know the Federal Reserve was private. They said it was anti-Semitic if you said that the Federal Reserve was private. Now everybody knows. The point is, because of the patriots, not just me, but Ron Paul and G. Edward Griffin, and people like Matt Drudge and WorldNet Daily and countless others, folks understand what's happening. People understand the truth. They're aware of what's going on. A core of people, a few hundred million worldwide probably. If we now just get the word out to everybody else, the globalists won't be able to carry out this program of global impoverishment, of global Cloward and Piven to domesticate us and make us dependent like literal prisoners. So the good news is we're not flat-footed here. We knew this was coming. And now we need to understand that our stock as patriots, as anti-globalists, as true nationalist sovereign promoters of basic freedom and common sense and family, that our stock's going up. And we don't need to be arrogant about it. We need to be leaders about it and state that we understood that was happening, get out of the cognitive dissonance, get out of the mind control, and take action now. All right, I'm signing off. I'll be calling in live if I'm able to, should be able to. I have a two-hour layover in Chicago. I should see you sometime in the 1 o'clock hour. God bless you all now. David Knight in the InfoWars News Center in Austin, Texas.
And again, that's Alex Jones. He's reporting on the road. That was recorded earlier. He is in the air while we're on the air, but he's going to be joining us in the third hour, unless there's any problems with traveling. We're going to be joined in the next hour by Harry Dent, who is going to break down what he's told us in the past, what the fundamentals are in this. We've got a lot of people that have been on the Alex Jones show recently talking about how they expect a massive market sea change coming up in September. This is a bit early. Is this the change that everybody's been expecting, or is this just the beginning of a massive change? There's an article up on InfoWars.com. Black Monday, stock markets collapse amid global sell-off. Peter Schiff, Ron Paul, and others warned this would happen. This is an article by Kit Daniels. And you can look at this article. You can see many of the recent interviews that we've had with people saying that this is exactly the sort of thing that was going to happen. And of course, this morning, there was an article by Paul Joseph Watson from an analyst saying we are now in a full-on market crash. And this morning, when this article came out, they were pointing out that last week, the Dow Jones lost 6%. It tumbled more than 1,000 points. It actually went down 888 points the last 2 days of last week. And there's a quote there from, when a market tips into a crash on a Friday, what typically happens is that thousands or even millions of investors who believe the mainstream media didn't see it coming, spend the weekend stewing over their investments. Many of them decide to bail out come Monday. It would not be surprising, he says, to see the Dow Jones Industrial drop by 800 to 1,000 points in one day. Well, now we've been there, we've done that. This morning when it opened up, it dropped 1,000 points, the largest single-day decline in history. That's an article from Kurt Nimmo up on InfoWars.com. They point out that it fell 6.6%. This is when it fell today, and of course, this triggered some interesting checks. There was also in China, they actually put in brakes to keep the market from falling further. Even in the United States, we had Rule 48 invoked for the very first time in history. The Dow and the SP were halted momentarily. to keep that from happening. This is a flash crash rule that was put in place after the flash crash of 2010. And this is the first time they have invoked that. So what's going on in China? Let's look at China first. Global stock shock. China's stock market crash accelerates, down 8.5% as a panic in global markets accelerate. As they point out, a sign of a panic is when traders place a higher probability of volatility in the short term than the longer term. They say that's what we're seeing now. The short-term premium is nearly 20%. It has been higher only during the worst of the 2008 crisis, the flash crash in May 2010, and near the low in August 2011. To put this in perspective, another article points out that this is from Pete Sweeney, China stocks give up year's gains as national team stays on the bench. They point out Chinese stock market slumped today, with even some state media saying the government rescue attempts had now failed. Chinese markets were down more than 9% during the day, had only slightly recovered by the close of trading in China, because they're closed now. The worst daily performance since 2007, a hair's breadth from the worst day since 1996. This comes after markets lost 11% last week. So understand that, 11% last week, 9% today in China. The downside was limited mostly by rules that prevented any given stock from losing more than 10% in a day, and by the fact that many company shares are still under trading halts. 80% of China's tradable stocks hit the downside limit during the day. So understand, they've got checks when a stock falls more than 10% in a day, and 80% of the stocks had that check go into effect today. So again, 11% last week, 9% today. It would have been much further probably if they hadn't had those halting trades, those stops in there. And again, 80% of the stocks hit that. They say exchanges not only gave up all the gains made from Beijing's unprecedented stock market rescue in July, in which hundreds of billions of Chinese state dollars were ordered into the market, they have now also for the first time entered negative territory for the year. Now, hundreds of billions of dollars. It was actually $141 billion that Goldman Sachs estimated that Beijing put in to prop up the markets this year. That is all going on the wayside. Now, what is the U.S. administration doing? Well, there's an interesting link on the Drudge Report about our Treasury Secretary. And I want to play you a clip of what he has to say. Let's play that clip, guys. This is Jack Lew, the Treasury Secretary of the Obama administration.
But I will say that China's markets are still pretty much separated from world markets. They're obviously moving towards being more integrated, but right now they're not. So you're not going to, I don't think, see the direct linkage there. I think the concern that is a real one is, what does it mean about long-term growth in China?
Yeah. Okay. So that was the beginning of July. That is our clueless Lou. That is Jack Lew, the Treasury Secretary of the Obama administration, speaking to the liberal think tank Brookings Institution, explaining to them how there is no connection between our market and the Chinese market. There you go. Now, the 1,000 points that was lost at the beginning of trade today is now recovered up to, it's now down to 150 points. And so the question is, what's going to happen for the rest of the week? Before we do that, though, let me continue talking about Clueless Lou here. This is a guy, he's 60 years old. He's only had 2 years in the business sector. He's a lawyer by training. He's a Democrat Party apparatchik by profession. This is a guy who's been an advisor, an assistant to a lot of different politicians. He's hung out in the Democrat Party, except for 2 years when he was COO of Citibank. And I don't know if that was a payoff of things that he had done or anticipation of things that he would do for Citibank. After that, he moved back to the Obama administration, and then with absolutely no experience in business, really, except for that 2 years. Remember, the guy is 60 years old. He's had 2 years. He went straight to the top of Citibank without any business whatsoever, any business experience, I should say. No economic training. This is a guy who goes to the top of Citibank for 2 years, then becomes our Treasury Secretary, then last month tells the Brookings Institute that, of course, China's markets don't affect us. Of course they do. I mean, you don't need a business or economics degree to understand that a massive economy like China is going to have an impact on everyone. It's absolute insanity that he would say that. How disconnected, how clueless can you be? Well, it can get even worse. We've got Bernie Sanders, who tweets out that this is all the chickens coming home to roost, the results of unfettered free trade. Unfettered free trade. Okay. It's not a result of government manipulation of the markets, as we pointed out. It's not a result of unicorn currencies. It's not a result of artificially propped up interest rates. You know, since 2008, the Federal Reserve has essentially rigged the markets with 0% interest rates, while the banks, the big banks, are loaning the stuff out at usury rates. They're car loans, house loans, for the most part, especially credit card loans, are at levels that would have been illegal before Jimmy Carter was president. We never allowed banks to charge more than 10%. Now you're lucky if you can get something less than 10%, or if you can even get a loan. Because the other part of this, of course, is that Dodd-Frank, in the name of reform, that's the kind of reform we got from the Democrats, is that we're going to take care of Wall Street. Yeah, they took care of Wall Street. They made it impossible for mom and pop to get a home loan pretty much without going through a mountain of paperwork so onerous that most of the small banks have been driven out since Dodd-Frank came in. Too much regulation for them to process home loans, or most types of loans for that matter. Only the big banks can afford to do this. So using regulation of Dodd-Frank, they've essentially shut down the credit market. They have shut down a lot of their competitor banks. Meanwhile, they get the money for free. What do they do with it? Are they loaning it out to activate the economy? No, because of these loans, these laws, they're not loaning anything out. They're keeping the money on deposit with the Federal Reserve, where they can earn some money. They're not investing it. So that's why we're not seeing anything there. But of course, as Alex is breaking down what is behind this, we're looking at the numbers here that happened today. But of course, we've been talking about this for a very long time. As I mentioned, you can see that story on Infowars.com. The multiple interviews that we've had with economists, with Ron Paul, with others, talking about what is behind this. And of course, this is something that has been rolling on for a very long time. A lot of people have seen this coming for the obvious reasons. This is a controlled economic takedown. They want to have economic chaos. You can look at the stories throughout the world of massive migration into the first world. This creates both a social and an economic problem, an inability to assimilate the people quickly enough, and an inability to be able to provide for them. It creates economic crisis. It divides the population. It balkanizes the population. We had over 3,000 people that were picked up in the Mediterranean trying to get into Italy just in one day this weekend. So this is happening all over the Western world. This is a planned economic takedown. Now, what's going to happen from here on out? One more economic article here. From panic to judgment day, investors struggle to describe the route. This is from Bloomberg. They say as global markets tumbled, investors, strategists, and asset managers across the world struggled for words to describe the sell-off that wiped $490 billion from emerging market equities, that dragged Saudi stocks into a bear market, pushed Russia's ruble toward its lowest closing level on record. And so the words that they're struggling to use, we see things like panic, judgment day, carnage, meltdown, fearful, depressing, psychologically draining. One guy says it's just plain ugly. So what's going to happen with this? Well, as I said, we're going to have Harry Dent is going to be talking to us in the next hour. He correctly called that this was something that was going to happen early September. It's actually earlier. We're going to get his opinion as to whether he thinks this is the end of it. I don't think it's the end of it. I doubt that he thinks it's the end of it. I think it is just the beginning of the end of a giant, massive bubble that has been put into place. And of course, we see that our government believes that as well. You can read the signs of that behind what they're doing. The massive urban military drills that we see everywhere. The divide and conquer strategy, predominantly along race lines, but also the black versus blue. When they militarize the police, they are interacting with people with over-the-top brutality in many cases, picking situations like the one in Ferguson, where it's not a clear case necessarily, but they want that ambiguity because then that fosters this kind of division again. If it's a clear case of a murder, they don't pay attention to that. They go to the ones where it's not a clear case, and they make that the biggest issue. Then, of course, we have the black versus white. Look at how the media pushed all of this Confederate flag issue to the nth degree. And as I mentioned before, the massive influx of immigrants throughout the West, that's what we've been looking at. That's what is something that's what we have to be concerned about. Now, there's an article on Drudge Report, and I thought this was interesting. This is from the former advisor to Gordon Brown in the UK. He's the former prime minister of the UK, Gordon Brown is. Says, stock up on canned food for a stock market crash. Now, how many times do you see a stock market crash where you have people advising to stock up on food? See, Damian McBride doesn't think that this is going to be just a stock market crash. He thinks this is going to be something far worse. And of course, the governments across the world have been preparing for this. They have also been instigating this. That's what we've been trying to tell you. This is a former advisor, Gordon Brown. He's urged people to stock up on canned goods and bottled water as stock markets around the world slide. This is from The Independent in the UK. Damian McBride appeared to suggest that the stock market dip could lead to civil disorder or other situations where it would be unreasonable for someone to leave the house. He gives three pieces of advice. Number one, get hard cash in a safe place. Don't assume that banks and cash points will be open or bank cards will work. Number two, do you have enough bottled water, tinned goods, other essentials at home to live a month indoors? If not, get shopping. Number three, agree on a rally point with your loved ones in case transport and communication get cut off, somewhere you can all head to. Again, this is a guy who worked as the senior advisor for the former Prime Minister Gordon Brown in the UK, telling people, get prepared. He clearly sees this as the people that we've been talking to here at InfoWars. He clearly sees this as not only an economic bubble crash, but something that could get much, much worse. And that's what we've been telling people. So let me tell you that we still have this sale on Silver Bullet. If you want to prepare, you need things, not only water, not only food, but you need some things that are going to help you medically. You need things that are going to help to keep you in good health so that when you go into a situation like this, you're not automatically looking to see where you're going to get your next supply of some kind of a pharmaceutical that's not going to be available. Try to get yourself in as good a health as possible. Try to have things on hand that are going to help you in an economic crisis. We have through Wednesday still this sale on Silver Bullet, 30% off, or if you buy two, you can get two for free. That's at InfoWarsLife.com. If you buy two, you get it at 50% off because you'll get four bottles. If you buy one, you can get it at 30% off. That's our colloidal silver product, 30 parts per million, and a pure base of deionized water. So right now you can get that at InfoWarsLife.com. You can also stock up on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. We're going to be back. We're going to break this down farther, and we're going to have Harry Dent joining us in the second hour. Alex Jones will be back with us live in the third hour. Stay with us. We'll be right back. A day that began with about a 1,000-point drop in the stock market. It was down a little bit over 6%. Articles were coming out saying that the New York Stock Exchange would totally suspend trading for 15 minutes if it dropped to 15%. So they were very concerned that it was going to happen at that point. It has now rebound to being down about 1% for the day, 169 points down. But understand that just as we saw with China last week, they lost 11% of their stock market value over the week and 9% today. It would have been far worse if they had not stopped trading on most of the stocks. 80% of the stocks fell by 10%, and that automatically triggered a stop trade on those stocks. So it could have been far worse today. Nevertheless, we're still looking at 9% in a single day after 11% for a week. Here's an article from Bloomberg. Here's what usually happens to markets after the S&P 500 drops 5% in a week. They say last week was a brutal one. Of course, the stock market tumbled here 5% for the week. And again, at the beginning of the day, it tumbled 6%. It is now down 1%. They say a weekly drop of more than 5% has only happened 28 other times since 1980. And of course, we had a drop today of more than that. They say on average, the market is relatively flat the next week. It is up 1.65% over the next 4 weeks, up close to 5% over the next 12 weeks. They say it's also important to note that 60% of the time, the index moves higher the following week. Well, we have yet to see that. It is still down 1%, and this is halfway through the day. When I came in this morning looking at the news monitors that we have here at about 8:30 when they started the stock market, it was like watching the ball drop on New Year's Day in Times Square. And that was basically what happened to the stock market index. It was pretty amazing to see that. Now it is climbing its way back slowly. We'll see what happens. The fundamentals, however, and what we've been warned about by expert after expert, people who really do know economics, not people like our Treasury Secretary, who says that there is no connection whatsoever between the Chinese markets and the rest of the global markets. How clueless can you get? Clueless Lou, Jack Lou, the Treasury Secretary. And as I pointed out, this is a man with absolutely no economic training, no business experience. He came in as a CEO of Citibank after working his entire life as a Democratic Party apparatchik. That was not there because of his merit, folks. You don't spend all your life as a legislative assistant and a lawyer and then somehow get put in a high position at Citibank. That is a payola position. It's not there because he knows anything about economics, and he just illustrated last month how totally clueless he is about all of this. So what do you do? As we pointed out, we've got a former advisor to Gordon Brown, who is the who's a prime minister of the UK, telling people, stock up on water, stock up on food. Make sure you know how to get in touch with your loved ones in case you lose all your communications. He sees this as something that is far more than just a stock market drop. This is something that is happening now a week before we get into September. Everybody was looking at September as a time frame that they felt this might happen. And of course, you can't exactly call all of these things. You can see the underlying trends, but the underlying trends are still there. In spite of what may happen today, in spite of crash protection teams pumping the market back up to try to get it back up, even we saw what happened with that last week. We've had several weeks now. China has been trying to prop up their market. They have now lost that $140 billion that they put in there. An interesting story that was up on Daily Mail. A survivalist rides out the Washington wildfires. What did he do? He built a concrete dome home. He got in it. A 20-foot wall of fire went over him. Folks, there's reasons to prepare. And even an assistant to the former prime minister of the UK is telling you to prepare. Stay with us. We're going to be right back in the next hour with Harry Dent. He's going to be talking to us about what's ahead.
He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Monday, August 24th, 2015. This will be a day that will go down in stock market history. We've seen a tremendous amount of volatility. The stock market closing, opening at 1,000 points down, dropping about 6% in value. It has now climbed back to being down about 1% in the market. It is a historical day. What is behind this? As I mentioned, a former advisor to the UK Prime Minister is advising people to make preparations. Get your water, get your food, make plans on what to do. As I mentioned just before we went to break, a survivalist built a dome home, a concrete dome home that he built back in the late 90s. He survived the massive wildfires out in Washington with no harm to him, no damage to his home, even though it was hit with a 20-foot wall of flame. What do you need to do to protect yourself? What will the government do to protect you? I think it's very interesting to look at the aftermath of this situation on the French train. Of course, that was three Americans who stopped a terrorist on the train. Everybody else on the train was running for cover. The officials on the train were locking themselves in rooms and just leaving the passengers to fend for themselves. The Americans took this guy down, and now he's laughing and says, terrorist, I wasn't a terrorist. I just found these guns, the AK-47 and the pistol. I just found those on a children's playground under a bush. That's what he's telling people. I had absolutely nothing to do with that. Well, we knew right from the very beginning. We had a story up on Infowars.com that, yes, he had a long history. He was known by security forces. He had traveled multiple times to Syria. He had links to U.S.-trained and Gulf Emirate-financed terror groups. It's also a report on Daily Mail that he fought with ISIS in Syria. He was known to four intelligence agencies. Of course, they're always going to say that. They always say that, oh, yeah, we knew all about that. Well, if they did, why didn't they do anything about it? Well, because they are not there to protect you. As a matter of fact, they're creating this kind of unrest. One more thing before we get off of Europe. Here we've got paintball guns given to Belgian cops in a bid to stop Charlie Hebdo, they say. Police in a Belgian city are now being armed with paint guns, semi-automatic firearms used to in densely populated areas. In other words, they don't want to give them real guns, so they're giving the police paint guns. Police bosses hope they'll be able to neutralize dangerous suspects without actually killing them. You think? What are they gonna, when they've got an AK-47 and you've got a paintball gun, how do you think that's going to work out? Don't bring a paintball gun to a gunfight, okay? It's not a real gun. Newsflash, okay? They say this is because of raids on the satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo. I thought this was satire when I saw it. I thought this looked like something out of The Onion, but this is what they're actually doing in Belgium. You cannot rely on the government to protect you. Take the steps you need to protect yourself. Build yourself some kind of a resistant shelter. Stock up on what you need. You cannot trust the police to protect you. As a matter of fact, it's getting far worse. Over the weekend, we had even Henry Kissinger amazed at what our government is doing. He said the Ukraine is a failed attempt to break Russia, is what Henry Kissinger said. He says, stop backing Kiev at all costs. He says, breaking Russia has become an objective for U.S. officials. The long-range purpose should be to integrate it. In other words, he wants to take it over. He wants to control the world. But even Henry Kissinger is saying, what's the matter with these guys? They're trying to create World War III. They're trying to create a global war. Exactly. Exactly. That's what we've been telling you. They're militarizing the police at home. They're setting different groups against each other. They're allowing massive immigration, incentivizing massive immigration. I mean, you talk about the wall. Let's understand what Obama did. He gave all of these benefits by executive order, things that could not get passed in Congress. He gave this to people. We've got refugees coming in throughout Europe. And of course, even Henry Kissinger is saying, what are they doing? It is absolutely crazy. Stay with us after the break. We're going to talk to Harry Dent about what is ahead. We'll be right back. We have joining us now Harry Dent. Harry Dent is no stranger to those of you who listen to the Alex Jones radio show. He's been on many times and he's been forecasting that this is exactly the type of thing that would be happening. This is a long-term trend, and that's what Mr. Dent specializes in. Harry Dent is a founder of Dent Research, an economic forecasting firm specializing in demographic trends. His mission is helping people understand change. In his book, The Great Boom Ahead, that was published in 1992, Mr. Dent accurately forecasted the unanticipated boom of the 90s and the continued expansion into 2007. In his most recent book, The Demographic Cliff, he continues to educate audiences about his predictions for the next Great Depression, especially between 2014 and 2019, that he's now been forecasting for over 20 years. He's an editor of the Survive and Prosper newsletter. His website is harrydent.com. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Dent. Your mission is helping people understand change. Help us understand what's going on today.
Well, you know, David, as we've been saying, it's really very simple. We had a very strong combination of new technologies, internet, computers, wireless phones, broadband, all these things, just like autos and electricity and the roaring 20s and stuff. These technologies were moving mainstream, brought in and accentuated by the largest generation in history, not just here, but all around the world, the baby boom generation. So that's why we focus on demographics. It's people that basically innovate when they're young. It's people who spend and raise their kids and buy houses and all the big things in the economy and borrow money to do that in that state. And it's people who finally save and invest for their retirement. And economists ignore this because they weren't taught this. I learned this in my marketing courses in college and Harvard Business School. And then I learned how things move in stages at Harvard Business School and Bain & Company. And so I've always looked at stages of technology and innovation, and I've always looked at demographics. Those are two things economists really don't understand at all, and they will tell you where the economy is going, not just a year or two from now, which is not good. I can tell you what's going to happen, and we've been doing this since the late 80s. We've been predicting the major changes in economics and economy and markets since the late 80s when I put these two things together after 10 years of research. So it's a different approach. It's something people understand because it's about people. Everything I do is not about governments, whether they're going to do more QE or not, or whether they're going to stimulate this way or run deficits or not. All of these things have an impact. Zillions of people around the world have a much greater impact. And I know what people do from cradle to grave down to when they spend the most money on potato chips, not just when they spend the most money overall at age 46 to 47.
Exactly right. And when we look at this, everybody's saying, well, you know, the Chinese markets are crashing, so everything else is crashing. But what is really driving this, of course, as you're pointing out, is a global economic slowdown that is demographically based. I mean, the reason that their manufacturing inventories are going up is because people are buying less. It's one of the reasons why the oil prices are crashing, is because the Saudis kept production up even though demand was crashing. And so that's really the driving force on all this, isn't it, Mr. Dennis? The demand that is crashing. Yeah, this is a reflection of that.
Exactly. People say, you know, supply driven or something. Don't produce more when there isn't demand. People are saying, oh, we need to do, you know, produce more and invest more. No, we overexpanded in the great boom with too much debt. Consumers overbought with too much debt, and now those two things are going the other way. We've got oversupply, falling demand, increasingly indebtedness. And the point I make, David, which is even more important, no matter what we did in the United States and what Europe did, China is the new player on the block, and they did something nobody's ever done. They overbuilt their economy at every level: housing, basic infrastructures, industrial capacity. And created more debt pushed by and guaranteed by the government than any country relatively in the same time, moved 500 million people in the last 2.5 decades from rural areas to cities, the biggest migration ever. Hey, that's natural, but they did it all too fast on steroids. What is causing this final bubble to burst, which needs to burst because demographics and debt need to kind of let this thing deleverage, is China has been the biggest thing keeping this global bubble going. We've been predicting for years, China is slowing. They're not growing at 7%. They're lying about that. They're growing at 3 to 4%. But at some point, their real estate bubble, way bigger than ours, 5 times bigger than ours, was. And their overbuilding bubble is going to burst. And China's burst is going to continue to kill commodity prices. That kills emerging countries around the world, which do have good demographics. And it backs up on us. And that's what's happening right now. Why is our market going down today, 1,100 points at worst on the Dow, even though it bounced back? Because China's market collapsed last night to new lows, and it's down like 40% in the last few months. That's saying a bubble is bursting. We've already seen our bubble start to burst in 2008, many other bubbles around the world. But China is the epicenter of this global demographic slowdown and this global excess of debt and credit and global financial asset bubbles. You only get asset bubbles, stocks and real estate and all these things, when credit is easy and cheap, especially artificially by the government. And when those things burst, they don't correct, and they don't correct slowly, they crash. So we've been warning your audience and our subscribers that you should get out of this bubble early. A bit early, not late, because once it goes down, you see things like now where you know, markets are down 6% in one day. In 1987, and this is during a boom, but we did have a bubble in stocks in the 87, we saw stocks correct 40% in just 2 weeks, and 20%, half of that, 20% in one day. So we're telling people this is not a correction, not something you should sit through. We've told people to get out ahead of it. Now it's starting to get crazy. It's going to go up and down because it went down 1,100 points a day and back up 1,000 from there. We're going to see this with a downside bias for a couple years and even more years off and on. This is a time to protect your capital, get out of the markets, protect yourself, live in a safe place, do everything you can. This is going to be the worst downturn, the worst crash we see in our lifetimes. And I've been saying that not just in the last few years. I've been saying this since my research came together in the late 80s.
You know, it's amazing. This article that we covered earlier that was on the Drudge Report about a former advisor to Gordon Brown, former prime minister of the UK, and he's talking about a full-on prepper. He's telling people, get your water, get your food. I mean, what do you think about that, Mr. Dan? I mean, he's talking to people as if this is an impending major crisis that is going to go way beyond anything that's just a stock market sell-off. He believes, as many of us do, that this is going to be a massive societal change. He looks like he thinks it's going to be a disruption that could threaten people's survival. They need to get their own supply of food and water.
Well, you know, that's where it gets harder to predict, but I do lean in that direction because it's not just our demographic cycle. I have a geopolitical cycle that goes back 200 years, going up for 18 years, everything's hunky-dory in the world, and then down. We've been in a down cycle since 9/11, 2001 to 2019 or 20. So what we see happening in the Middle East and in around the world and Russia and Ukraine, this is only going to get worse by this cycle, and it may start to turn around in 4 or 5 years. So when we put all our cycles together, I have four long-term cycles that all point down between 2014 and early 2020. Some point down longer, but that is the danger period. We also have short-term, what I call the crash season, when there are major downturns in the stock market and economy. The worst crashes tend to come between mid-August, just recently, as we're starting to see, in mid-October. So I am seeing, in the next 4 years, especially in an extreme danger zone. And so I tell people, yes, go across the board, not just get out of stocks and real estate and have cash and liquid stuff you can use to survive, because cash is king in a downturn, especially a deflationary downturn where everything is going down, all assets, the economy, everything, prices of consumer goods are going down. But also where you live. If you're in a major city, you want to be in the outskirts, on the exurban edges. If you can move to a smaller town or to a safer place in the Caribbean, so and so, do that. Be in a safer place. Don't be in a bubble city, especially. Don't be in downtown New York or San Francisco or Miami, the places that have bubbled the worst. And yes, you should have some provisions up. You should be saying, what if we have some civil unrest? What if our infrastructures go down for a period of time? You know, do I have basic things? I think all of that is warranted. I don't know how extreme that will be, because one of the problems I have is we don't have a precedent for this. Our cycles work up and down throughout history. We've had inflationary periods like the 70s, deflationary periods like the 30s, and they're always the worst. But we've never seen a period like this where there's been so much stimulus and so much stretching of the economy and printing of money and free money, and so much polarity between the rich and the everyday people. That, I mean, that polarity alone says there's going to be conflict. The fact that the more Democratic and Republican sides of our economy can't agree on anything, that they're both blaming each other for this bubble and this crisis, means, you know, there is definitely much more likely to be some level of civil unrest. I would just be happier to be here than China. Otherwise, you know, This country does definitely have potential for that.
You know, it's amazing, as I pointed out in the last segment, even Henry Kissinger is sounding the warning about how close we are to war, questioning why we are pushing above all else against Russia, pushing so hard in an area where obviously the Ukraine has always been attached to Russia. They see that just as if it was a part of the United States that had been annexed about that long ago. And so even Henry Kissinger is questioning this and saying, what are they doing? Why are they pushing to war? Of course, he knows what the long-term plan is. He would rather see this assimilated gradually. We're talking to Harry Dent, harrydent.com, founder of Dent Research. We're going to be right back, talk to him about the long-term demographic changes. What's coming in 2020? Many people have talked about that specific date. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. Alex Jones is going to be joining us in the next hour live. We had him at the beginning of the show commenting about how this was something that was not unexpected. We've had many guests who have been predicting this over the last several months. Of course, this has been going on even longer than that. We've been seeing this build up as a demographic trend, as actions that our government has been taking, preparing for a massive collapse. They know it. We know it. Many people have predicted it. None better than Harry Dent. And of course, he is an expert on demographic trends. His book, his most recent book, The Demographic Cliff, is about a great sea change that we're going to see between 2014 and 2019. He wrote this many years ago. We are now in the middle of this. He was on just a couple of months ago, I think, or maybe just about within the last month, predicting that this was going to be happening in the September, early September time frame, and here we are. It's happening right about that time frame. I'm going to get back to Mr. Dent in just one moment. Before I do, I just want to let you know that we now have Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine in stock. This hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by your support of the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine has over 400 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of the respondents would recommend this to a friend or a family member. It's a great way for you to prepare, to stock up, so that you have nutritional supplements as well as food and water available in case there is some kind of a crisis. Let me read you a couple of the reviews that are on InfoWarsLife.com about Survival Shield X2. We got one from DB in Minnesota. He says, I really like this product. The biggest plus I've noticed is more energy and just feeling all around better. I strongly recommend this product, and I'm grateful to Alex for offering it. Another one from Special K in Winter Springs, Florida says, I love Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. Helps bring focus and clarity to my mind. It also improves the quality of my sleep. Thank you, InfoWars Life, for sourcing 200 million-year-old salt solutions found more than 7,000 feet below the Earth's surface for this high-quality formula. Yes, it's a very pure form of iodine. And again, we have a sale on Silver Bullet. You can get 30% off. This is a sale that is going to end on Wednesday. You can get 30% off, or you can buy two Silver Bullet, get two free. Again, that's at InfoWarsLife.com. Getting back to Harry Dent, Mr. Dent, your time frame that you have on this is 2014 to 2019. Of course, it's based on demographic trends with baby boomers. Tell us what you think is going to happen in 2020, because we've seen so many people predicting these massive sea changes happening around 2020. I've seen this over and over again from every kind of scientific prediction about the future to a government prediction. They all say, yeah, well, by 2020, we're going to have this, we're going to have that, where the self-driving cars or this or that. You picked 2019. Why did you pick that date?
Well, you know, it's really by the end of 2019, our demographic trends in the United States bottomed between 2020 and 22. There were demographic trends alone, I'd say we don't really turn around until 2023 forward. But we have this geopolitical cycle that's been negative since 9/11, and that bottoms around late 2019, early 2020, and that'll be the first thing to turn up. And we have a 10-year boom-bust cycle that turns up around early 2020. So we have a number of cycles. The demographics get as bad as it's going to get by 2020. So I'd say somewhere around late 1990, early 2020, we're going to see the worst of this. But we won't really, I think, see the next global boom. And it won't be as strong as the last one until around late 2022, early 2023, when I look at all of our cycles. So it's a broader view. I don't just look at demographics. Demographics just happens to be the most important and most predictable cycle we have. I mean, I can quantify it down. Again, we said 20-some years ago, baby boomers would peak by late 2007, and we would start an economic slowdown. And we did that. And we were about to crash into the next Great Depression. And then governments and central banks came around and printed like $10 trillion, $4.5 trillion in the United States alone, to fill in the gap. So this has been an artificial rally. All the money's gone to speculation, hasn't gone to lending and new jobs and new factories and production. It's just artificial, and it's just created another bubble. All this free money created by the government has created an even bigger bubble in one thing, not in inflation, not in growth, in financial assets. So you got to get out of financial assets. So the biggest thing we see happening is all financial assets, commodities, even gold, bonds, and stuff are going to deflate stocks into around 2019, 2020. Then the trends can start pointing up again. But until then, it's just better to be safe.
Again, we're talking to Harry Dent of Harry Dent Research. We're going to be right back with him, and we're going to talk about what happens with the economy as we turn the corner. But as you heard, get out of the stock market. He was making this prediction before. We'll be right back. Alex Jones is traveling. He's in the air right now while we're on the air. He's going to be joining us live, however, in the next hour. He joined us with a special report that he cut about what's going on in the stock market today. He cut that before he got on the plane. He will be joining us in the third hour. Right now, we were talking to Harry Dent, founder of Dent Research, and of course, he's an economic forecaster. He's been on the show many times. I'm sure that you've heard him, and most recently, predicting that we're going to have exactly this type of thing happening in this type of time frame, cautioning people to get out of the inflated stock market that we have, this economic bubble, this financial bubble, where they have poured all of this quantitative easing, all this money that's been printed has essentially, as he pointed out just before we went to break, it's found its way not in any other kind of economic growth except for a growth in a bubble stock market. Mr. Dent, you're talking about demographics, and I think one of the that's one of the key trends that you look at when you're forecasting. What about the massive influx of immigrants that we're seeing in the United States as well as in Europe? We had 3,000 immigrants rescued in a single day in Italy over this weekend. We've had the Obama administration incentivize massive immigration into our country. How does that play into the demographics that we have with the baby boomers?
Well, first of all, it has greatly increased the demographics of the baby boom generation, even more than the millennial generation to follow them. And we've been an immigrant nation forever, especially the late 1800s, early 1900s, greatest immigration surge ever. And then we saw the great bubble and boom into the roaring 20s because of the technologies and that. It was much more immigration than births back then. Now we've seen another immigration surge that peaked recently and will decline for many, many years because in a bad economy, countries don't want to let as many immigrants in. And in a bad economy, immigrants don't want to take the risk of moving. And yes, we've had a huge illegal immigrant problem. But to send them all back, as Donald Trump says, to me is too much. You got to say, look, here's a period to reapply. Do X, Y, and Z. If you don't, we'll send you back. But if you suddenly sent back 11 million people, it would cost a fortune and the economy would go into recession on that alone. My view is this. Again, what a country should do, and I lecture a lot in Canada and Australia, these are countries that have a great immigration policy. They want immigration, but you have to not only just be legal, you have to qualify to be in. You got to be in the skills they need. You got to prove your valuable economy. Australia and Canada have very good immigration. Our immigration has still helped bolster our economy and take jobs that mean people wouldn't. But in a downturn, I'm telling you, we're going to turn anti-immigration.
Oh,
in
yeah.
a moment. That's what happened in the Great Depression. The greatest immigration surge in all of U.S. history went down to zero in the 1930s when the economy fell.
We're seeing that happening already in Europe. There were reports this weekend about what was going on in Germany. They had demonstrators there who were attacking the police who were guarding immigrants who had come into the country. And I guess when I look at this, what you're talking about is how we have to make sure that people have the ability to take care of themselves. Absolutely. But we're doing exactly the opposite. We're paying them to come in. We're incentivizing them to come in. We're telling them, come in, you can get free this, you can get free that, you can get college tuition, in-state rates at any state in the nation. And now we've got on the Democrat side, we've got Hillary Clinton as well as Bernie Sanders saying, let's give everybody free college. If you do that and you pull in the people, the dreamers that Obama is incentivizing to come in, remember, those kids, those children are considered to be children all the way up to the age of 31. That's what he considers to be children. That's how they've redefined children. So if they open up and give everybody free college tuition, that is truly going to be a massive, massive increase of the welfare state. Just as we're going to see a massive increase in the welfare state as people have to pay for more schools, we're seeing massive increases of people coming in. And we say, we'll give a free education to anybody in the world. And we'll even let you pick what language you want to get schooled in. And we'll send the bill to the people who own homes in the area. I mean, that's what we're seeing happening now.
Well, you know, David, I hate to say we have the most convoluted immigration policy in history. I tell you, in the coming decades, all developed nations, except for a few small ones from Israel to Australia, are going to be declining in population, workforce, everything, because we're not having enough babies and immigrants help replace it. But you have to have an immigration policy that makes sense and that attracts the right people. And that's why we should study Australia and Canada and Switzerland and countries like this that have done it successfully. We've done it haphazardly, and it still worked to our advantage overall. But it's going to be a huge issue because we didn't do it the right way. And now we got to debate how do we undo it And I don't agree with the extreme of Trump saying, send them all back and then bring the best ones back in. But we got to do something to get clear about this and have better policies. But I tell you, David, I don't think immigration is going to be a big policy in a downturn that I'm predicting in the next 4 to 7 or 8 years. Immigrants are not going to want to go in as much, and people here are even more not going to want them to come in. Immigration is going to, it's already net zero for many years in Mexico, our biggest immigration source. I think it's going to go down even more. I don't think we need to build the wall yet, because I don't think there's going to be a lot of immigration in a down economy. That's something to worry about for the next boom. We need to shoulder up our financial markets and our banking systems and stuff that are way out of kilter and have been totally killed by special interests. Special interest is the worst single thing in our economy. We can't change healthcare. We can't change education. We can't fight inflation. We can't deleverage debt, because there's too many financial interests that have bought their way into politics that won't let the politicians on either side do it. So we almost, one of the reasons I welcome this kind of downturn and this collapse, it's going to bring everybody into reality. We got to get back down to, what are we really doing? How do we really grow? We don't grow by stocks buying, companies buying back their stocks. We don't grow by printing free money. We don't grow by having zero interest rates, which just causes people to misinvest and stuff. We grow by saving and investing in productive capacity, creating new jobs, attracting good immigrants that are necessary, and having more babies. You know, that's how we grow down the road. And technological innovation, which we kill through all types of excessive regulation. So there's so many things we could do right. We've been doing the wrong things because special interests have been driving the economy the way they want it through the politicians. And that, if I had to say number one thing I would do if I were Donald Trump and won the presidency, and this is one thing I agree with him on, clearly, you've got to kill this thing where special interests can fund politicians and get them elected. That should not be allowed.
Absolutely. You mentioned technological innovation. Let me ask you, in your analysis, how do you see the predictions of massive automation and robotics and the displacement of workers? How do you see that playing out? A lot of people say, well, we've had a lot of these types of displacing, disruptive technologies in the past. We've seen it happen with agriculture. We've seen it happen with manufacturing. But then on the other hand, we've had people who have said, this is something that is so broad-based, it's going to hit every industry at the same time in a massive way. Are we going to look at 50% unemployment? I know some people will be fixing some robots. Some people will be manufacturing robots for a while, then manufacture robots can manufacture themselves. But how do you see this shaking out in your analysis?
Okay, David, how do you get more extreme than 80% of agriculture and mining and trapping workers going down to 2% today over the last century and a half? We always displace old jobs and create better ones. We went from agriculture to industry, production and manufacturing, from manufacturing to high-level service. I don't mean just clerical stuff and McDonald's and stuff. I mean healthcare, financial services, high technology, these sort of stuff. Every change in technology throughout history, and this is so consistent, if you look at history, you can't miss it, destroys old industries and jobs and creates new ones. The automobiles and tractors and trucks and buses and then eventually airplanes help destroy the railroad industry. They're a tiny thing now, but we're much better off. There will be new jobs created. My fear is they'll be created somewhere else because our demographics are weakening. We're aging. If we don't do something to change that, if we don't encourage innovation and higher birth rates and things, which some countries in Europe have, and which Australia has, and Israel is like the best demographic wealthy nation in the world forward, and they're a leader in technology. That's the key to going forward. You got to go with the technology. You can't fight it and say, oh, robotics are going to replace a lot of factory workers. Well, you know.
Well, certainly, yeah. You can't legislate that out of existence. But I guess what I've seen a lot of people say is, yeah, we've seen this happen with industry after industry, but we have the potential with this particular disruptive technology to have it happen to so many different industries simultaneously, to the service industry, to the transportation industry, to white collar, blue collar jobs. I mean, you know, everybody, we're not going to need truck drivers nearly as much as we do now, perhaps, is what a lot of people are saying in terms of package delivery, long-term haul, that type of thing. So there's going to be so many different industries affected simultaneously that even if we eventually adjust to this, it might send this shock through the system of 50% unemployment or 60% unemployment for a few years before we can adjust to that shock. Do you see that coming? Are you concerned about that?
No, I don't. Temporarily, yes. David, I mean, I've studied history more than anybody I know. And we got computers that I call left brain machines. They can do everything from bookkeeping to, and robotics can do auto, you know, typical routine tasks in factories and stuff. They can even do a lot of what doctors and nurses do and all, and financial advisors and everything. But what this revolution is about is forcing everyday people with common sense, creative, relational skills, which computers have none of that, at least not yet, not for a long time, to become entrepreneurs, whether you're an entrepreneur running a small part of a corporation, a team of three or four people that has a set of customers, and you're making decisions. Now, people are good at making decisions that balance off different trade-offs, relating to people, creating, finding new opportunities. Everyday people, I once heard a guy at a conference say, 95% of people are a genius at something, you know, and everybody else is my brother-in-law, you know?
That's right. Everybody has a different kind of an intelligence. That's right.
Yeah. It's about leveraging what computers can't do, and that's about making what we do that computers can't do is we create new stuff, new ideas. We relate to people. We understand their needs at a level a computer never could. I have a whole part of a chapter in chapter 8 in the demographic cliff, and I've had this in every book for the last 20 years, and nobody listens to it. The network corporation. You run companies from the bottoms up, organized around the customers, not the back lines and the bureaucrats and the managers. You automate all the bureaucracy. You make decisions in real time, and you let the customer drive your company. Your front lines are your browsers. Your backline experts and production facilities are your servers. The management isn't there to tell people what to do. They're there to orchestrate a network that runs with no management, just like the stock exchanges. You ring the bell at 9:30 in the morning like today. Stocks are down 1,100 points. And then at the end of the day, they're back up another 1,000. It all happens with no orchestration. The computer and technologies allow us to have a whole different model of interacting globally, locally, bottoms up, not top down. And when you make an everyday person an entrepreneur instead of a robot, which they are today, that's why they're being replaced by robots, you have a whole revolution. That's going to take a while, but I'll tell you, you never lose by advancing technologies. I've studied history back as far as there were ever humans. You never lose. Some people lose, and for time periods you lose. You never lose with advancing technology.
I understand. Yes, I agree. But, and just to clarify, do you see this as something that is going to happen, though, in the time frame of the 2019, 2020, that there's going to be some kind of an economic shock while we go through a period of adjustment? Or do you think going to be a relatively easy transition to this?
No, it's not an easy transition. It does take a shock. You know, it's like, you know, your heart stops and they got to go boom, you know, they got to reshock you going. It does take a shock. Management doesn't like this. The people in charge don't like this. Wall Street doesn't like this. We need to shift to this new network, bottoms-up economy, and the people in power still want it to be a top-down economy. It's going to take this kind of breakdown to have a breakthrough. So it'll take many decades for us to see the benefits of this. The whole assembly line revolution and automobiles, the whole Alfred Sloan corporate model of decentralizing decision-making in the product lines instead of like the railroads, everything was top down. That took decades to fully manifest into an affluent economy, middle-class economy in the 50s and 60s, but the shock that made it happen was the depression of the 1930s. It forced companies that weren't doing the right things to fail and the ones that were doing the right things to accelerate and get more market share. So this is part, the winter season we talk about is part about shifting to the whole new spring season of the next longer term boom with, you know, growing demographics again, with whole new sets of technologies. But the most important impact I found, David, through studying history is not just the cell phones let us communicate better or the internet and stuff. It's that they change the business model of everything, small businesses, large businesses, government. It changes the business model and makes everybody more productive.
You know, you mentioned the winter season that we're coming into and then followed by a spring season. Are you familiar with the works of Strauss and Howe, where they talk about a cyclical thing? And how do you feel about that? I mean, they predicted the fourth turning around the same type of time frame that you're talking about, a winter season. They predicted a fourth turning where we might have something along the lines of the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, World War II, these types of things happening every 70 to 80 years. Do you believe that's a trend that you see?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I did the whole thing demographically and the effects on the market and the economy. They did it after, you know, in 1989, about the same time I was putting out my first book. They did it all about the political and social impacts. When their book came out, I was like, praise God that these people came out and basically filled in the side that I'm not as much an expert in. I love Strauss and Howe. Mm-hmm. They have tracked history like I have. They've seen these 40 and 80 year generation cycles, which I see. They see these revolution cycles. And I've got an even bigger cycle, David, that back to the Revolutionary War and the Industrial Revolution and the birth really of capitalism with Adam Smith. That was in the late 1700s. We're in a similar revolution cycle in this decade and perhaps the next, where we're going to see major changes in our social, political, and capitalistic and business models and technology models. And 50 years from now, things are going to be massively different, but we have to go through this winter season, this deleveraging. I call it a financial detox in the next decade. And governments have been trying to prevent that by preventing this, as Japan has done. Japan's only extended their winter season, and they've never gone into spring. Japan's 20 years ahead of us on this cycle because of their demographics and their generation. They've just put it off with endless QE. It's the wrong thing to do. Trust the wisdom of natural systems, like you would trust your own body if you ate bad sushi, to flush it out as fast as possible.
Great advice. We're talking to Harry Dent, founder of Dent Research. We're going to be right back, and I want to ask you a question about if you see war in this massive turn. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We'll be joined in the next hour by Alex Jones live. He's in the air at the moment while we're on the air, but he will be landing and calling in to give us an update on his take as to what's been happening today. Of course, we've been talking about this for a very long time at InfoWars.com. We have many articles up right now. If you look at our website, Why Is Everyone Freaking Out About September 2015? An article by Paul Joseph Watts. Another one, Flashback, World-Renowned Economist Warns of Coming Crash of All Crashes. This is about Martin Armstrong's predictions. We're talking to Harry Dent, who has also been on our program many times, warning about this exact thing. We're going to get back to Mr. Dent of Dent Research in just a moment. I wanted to ask him, because we're talking before the break, about the cyclical nature of these different trends, the demographic natures of them, as well as he was familiar with the work of Strauss and Howe. He looked at this from an economic standpoint. They came along and looked at it from a political standpoint. And so I want to ask him if he sees in this winter season, as he calls it, or in the fourth turning, as they call it, if he sees a war coming up. Just briefly, at InfoWarsLife.com, we now have Prostagard back in stock. Prostagard uses plant-based nutrients and antioxidants to naturally support the prostate. Our advanced formula contains a hand-selected blend of saw palmetto, lycopene, plant sterols, zinc, vitamin D3, selenium, and copper. It's something I take every day for my research. It's something that men should really be adding to their daily routine, especially as you get older. Again, that's Prostagard. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Mr. Dent, as we were talking about in the last segment, we look at the historical cycles of this, about 70 or 80 years. You said you had identified this as well in your research, mainly from an economic standpoint. Strauss and Howe did it from a political standpoint. When we look at this, what we've seen in the past are things like World War II, then 70, 80 years before that, the Civil War, 70 or 80 years before that, the Revolutionary War. Do you see a war coming in this winter season, as you call it?
I do, but we've already seen it. It's a different type of thing. It's not like there's two giant powers or three giant powers that have a major war like World War I or World War II. What we've seen is since, and I pay more attention to our geopolitical cycle, which has been down from 2001 into 2019 or 20. That is the cycle when you have these sort of conflicts the most. And you know, we had the Iraq War and then the Afghanistan War. We've had civil wars throughout the Middle East. We've had terrorism around the world, civil wars in Africa. I mean, this is it. And since we don't have, China cannot attack the United States. We're not going to have war with China except for economic. The biggest threat right now is Russia moving into Ukraine. It's a Russia versus Europe and U.S. thing. I don't think it's going to be a nuclear war, but I think we're going to see civil wars continue to intensify in the Middle East and parts of the world. And this whole thing with Putin intensifies. So I think it's the same thing. It just continues and it gets worse. I don't think it's World War III, but there is going to be continued warfare and tensions. And we even have it internally with all types of racial tensions and stuff in this negative geopolitical cycle. I think that will start to abate 4, 5, 6, 7 years from now. And then 15 years from now, I don't think we'll be talking about terrorism as much in civil wars in the Middle East. But between now and then, yes. But I don't see an all-out World War III because I don't see who could really challenge us. It's just going to keep being a war here, a civil war here, a civil war there. And that's very disruptive to the economy and oil supplies and all types of stuff.
Very interesting. We're going to be back with Mr. Dent right after the break, and we're going to talk about his forecast through October because he had predicted a turn down early September. We're already starting to see that now. Where does he see this going in the next couple of months? Stay with us. We'll be right back with...
He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to be joined at the bottom of the hour by Alex Jones. Right now, we are talking to Harry Dent, founder of Dent Research. There's an article up on Infowars.com by Paul Joseph Watson. While the media peddled delusion, Infowars predicted the great crash of 2015. He says the financial press were still pretending it was a correction as recently as last week. And, of course, as he breaks this down, says this is what we reported 9 months ago. As he breaks this down, you'll see on this article featured prominently our guest right now, Harry Dent. He talks about how he and Gerald Celente, Peter Schiff, many others that we've talked to, talked about how this is going to happen. Many people have seen the handwriting on the wall, but not what you'll hear in the mainstream press. So I want to ask Mr. Dent now, where do you see this going in the next couple of months, Mr. Dent?
David, one of the things we've been warning your audience as well as our subscribers at HarryDent.com is that bubbles, when they burst, they get very violent. They build up violently on the upside. And then when they crash, typically the first crash in the first 2, 3, 4 months tends to be 30 to 40% or more. So people who wait for proof wait too late. And China just crashed 35% in 3 weeks, rebounded, and now it's back to new lows, which means it's going to crash again. The tech wreck in early 2000, in the first 2.5 months, the NASDAQ was down 40% in 2.5 months. It ended up 80% down, but most of it was right away. In the 1929 crash, the first 2 to 3 months was down 46%. So I don't really know fully because all crashes are different. And this time, I tell you, we've been telling people you're not going to see the Fed raise high rates in 2015 because we're going to be too weak by then. And they may be talking about QE4 before the end of the year. But I think the Dow could go as low as 13,000, be down 30% or more just by the middle of October. And one of the reasons for that, David, is that the worst time of year for stocks is mid-August to mid-October, but that is exaggerated in times when we're having bigger corrections or major downturns beginning. So again, I that's why I tell people, you know, we bounced today 1,000 points from the bottom after going down 1,100. If we bounce some this week, I just tell people every time there's a bounce, if you haven't already gotten out, get out, because short-term, the downside could be 30 to 40% in the next 2, 3, 4 months. And by late 2016 to early 2017, as we've said from the beginning, I fully expect the Dow to be at 5,800 or 6,000 or a bit lower, you know, like a 70% crash. And that will not be the end of the winter season, but it'll be the worst of it. So,
wow.
And we
wow.
just keep telling people, get out ahead. And the biggest problem, David, is, and because I've watched these things forever, once a crash like this starts, just like we saw today, when the market goes down 1,100, it can go up 1,000 points in the same day. It gets so volatile that everyday people have no chance. It's better to get out when it's good, just let it crash, and then rebuy when we see things better, like in late 2016, early 2017, or farther down the road, and then 2020 to 22. The secret, David, is to get out of the way like Joseph Kennedy did in late 29 and reinvest when the crash decimates everything, because playing the crash, unless you're a good trader, is very, very hard, because it goes up and down to such extremes. And again, we saw that today on Monday, August 24th, it's just down extremely, the biggest down market we've seen in a long time, and then up almost as much that day to counter it. And who can deal with it?
Yeah, it's such a major drop. I mean, it dropped over 6%. They would have stopped trading at 7%. So, I mean, that's exactly almost to that limit before it popped back up. So then, to reiterate what you're saying and have been saying for a long time, is that the fundamentals and the trends don't make sense. Be careful, because these crashes are front-loaded. You're going to see the biggest drop at the very beginning. Thank you so much for joining us, Harry Dent, harrydent.com. You can get more information about his forecasts and predictions. Thank you again for joining us, Mr. Dent. Stay with us. We'll be right back, and Alex Jones will be joining us at the bottom of the hour. This has been a roller coaster, a Black Monday, as a Twitter hashtag pointed out. A lot of people talking about the incredible volatility of the stock market today. We've just been talking in the last hour to Harry Dent of harrydent.com, Harry Dent Trends Research, about the trends that he sees happening with this. I want to get back to some of the news. Of course, Alex Jones is going to be joining us at the bottom of the hour. He joined us at the beginning of the program talking about how this has been something that our guests like Harry Dent, Gerald Celente, many others have pointed out, for Peter Schiff, have been pointing out for months and months, about the fundamentals, about the trends, about how we had suspended reality with the quantitative easing, with what the Federal Reserve was doing, with what the government was doing. Nevertheless, we have Bernie Sanders coming out and saying this is all the response, the result of an unfettered free market. How do you respond to that? That is just so far out in left field. I don't even know how to respond to that. When we've got a government that has kept interest rates flatlined at 0%, pouring money into a stock market bubble for years, 7 years since we've had this crash, 7 or 8 years they've been doing this. But of course, this is an unfettered free market. No, this is crony capitalism. This is Wall Street running the rules here. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. I want to talk about Nestle and drinking water, what we're learning about that out in California, because of course, we just had a former advisor to the former Prime Minister Gordon Brown of the UK sounding the alarm, sounding like a full-on prepper. Get cash, get water, get food, talk to your friends and family, make plans as to where you're going to meet in case you lose communications. I mean, this is the way he's reacting to this. He doesn't see this just as a stock market correction. He doesn't see this just as an economic correction. He sees this as something far bigger, and so do we. We've been seeing this happening for a very long time. As I point out at the beginning of the show, as we point out these urban training drills, the militarization of the police, the incessant provocateering of wars throughout the world by our government, we know what is happening with this. We know where they're moving in this. We can see the long-term cycles, the trends that are happening with this. Before I go back to the news, just want to let you know that we have Super Male Vitality back. It's available at InfoWarsLife.com. And of course, it's important for you to take care of your health. Make sure that you are in good health. If we're going into a difficult economic situation, a difficult societal unrest, you're going to need more than just food and water. Yes, you need those, but you also need good health. One of the ways that you can do that is to make sure that your body is getting the nutrition that it needs to stock up on this. We have been out of Super Male Vitality for quite some time. It is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. New Ultra Strength Super Male Vitality formula has hundreds of five-star reviews. You can read those at InfoWarsLife.com. Let me read you one of those right now. This is from Randy and Barb from Lake City, Michigan. They say, if anyone wants to know what their potential is, you need to try Super Male or Female Vitality. It's truly amazing as advertised. Another one from Stefan in Belgium says, I wouldn't want to be without this supplement. It gives energy during workouts and in the morning since I don't wake up easy. Love it. Look at the reviews. Decide for yourself if it's something that would help you. Again, you can see that at InfoWarsLife.com. That's how we support the operation, and it's how you can support your health. Now, if you're going to stock up on water, as the former advisor to the UK Prime Minister said, how is that going to look? Now, California is in the middle of an historic drought. And look at what's happening in this one article. When we talk about large companies getting control of everything, Nestle pays only $524 to extract 27 million gallons of drinking water in California, where there's a massive drought. This is truly outrageous. This shows the depth of corruption, the depth of crony capitalism. They say in 2013, the company drew 27 million gallons of water from 12 springs in Strawberry Canyon for the brand that they sell, the brand of bottled water, apparently by employing rather impressive Ledger Demain, considering the permit to do so had expired in 1988. It expired in 1988, but in 2013, they get 27 million gallons of water. But they paid for the expired annual fee. They did go back and pay that. All $524 of it, they say. Another 51 million gallons of groundwater were drawn from that area by Nestle the same year. So they have drawn 76 million gallons from the springs in that location, an area, an increase over 2013's 56 million gallon draw. To give you an idea of how large this is, they say that's 2,164 acre-feet of water, enough to irrigate 700 acres of farmland or to fill 1,068 Olympic-sized swimming pools. Now, what happens to that water? They get it for virtually nothing. Again, tens of millions of gallons of water in the middle of a record drought, and they pay $524 for it, and they sell it back to you for 89 cents per liter. If you look at their Arrowhead brand, which is 100% mountain spring water, 89 cents per bottle. So it puts the potential profit for Nestle's in the tens of billions. Yeah, that's the way this is going to shake down. And of course, water is one of the resources that they are working to get control of everywhere on the planet. So what is our government doing? Are they protecting us for this? Because, you know, we had Richard Nixon did what he could to protect us to keep our water and air clean by creating the EPA. So how's that working out for you, America? Well, we know that the EPA knew of this blowout risk for tainted water at the gold mine. This is the river that now has all this heavy metal that is flowing through it. It turned the river yellowish orange. We reported at the time that even before this happened, a miner with 47 years experience said, you know how this is going to happen? They're going to put this in, the back pressure is going to build up, it's going to blow out, and they're going to use that as an argument to come up with their pet project, which they had already floated. So he predicted that this was going to happen. He wrote about it in a local op-ed piece, and it happened precisely the way that he said it would. But now we know from internal documents, this is now the AP coming on. We reported that at InfoWars right after it happened. Now the AP is saying internal documents released last Friday show managers at the U.S. EPA were aware of the potential for a catastrophic blowout at an abandoned mine that could release large volumes of wastewater laced with toxic heavy metal. So yeah, they knew about it. They had actually written about it. They say they released the documents following weeks of prodding from the AP and other media organizations. EPA and contract workers accidentally unleashed 3 million gallons of contaminated water on August the 5th. They say this condition has likely caused impounding of water behind the collapse, said their report. In addition, other collapses within the workings may have occurred, creating additional water impounding conditions. Conditions may exist that could result in a blowout of the blockages, cause a release of large volumes of contaminated mine water and sediment from inside the mine, which contain concentrated heavy metals. So that's precisely what happened. They knew about it. An engineer knew about it, and he said, you know what? You're going to use this just like they always do. They manufacture a crisis, whether it is September 11th or whether it is a massive immigration of illegal aliens. They create the crisis, And then they use that as a problem to offer their solution. What is their solution? A massive EPA project. That's what's going to be coming down the pike. And of course, we look at another way that they're coming after us. When we're talking to Mr. Dent, he was basically sanguine about the technology trends that might happen in the future. I have always been a technology optimist. I was an engineer. I always thought that things were going to work out. I have decidedly moved to the pessimistic side. I saw the internet as something that ironically had been created by DARPA, something that I believed had gotten out of hand and let freedom loose. Now I'm kind of looking at this and wondering, was it a rope-a-dope all along? And so as we look at new technology, is it something that is going to be manipulated and controlled like the markets have? I mean, we were talking about Bernie Sanders' reaction to this earlier, saying, oh, this is unfettered free markets. No, it's not unfettered free markets. This is massive manipulation by governments and corporations of the market. Even today, we saw that in China, there was a 9% drop in the stock market. They had lost 11% of the value last week. A 9% drop in one day, it would have been far greater, except 80% of the stocks hit a forced cease trading order. Once they fall by a certain amount, I think it was 10%, then they stop trading, and 80% of the stocks had that. So nevertheless, it still dropped 9% in one day. And now as we're looking at the New York Stock Exchange, the Dow has now gone down 415 points. Understand that it went down 1,000 at the beginning of trading. They pumped this back up during the middle of the day, which we typically will see. The government will come in with its plunge protection team. They will buy back stocks and try to bring it back. This is the same game we saw being played in China over the last month or so. They poured $143 billion into the market. Now that has basically been wiped out. Doesn't look like they're going to get that back. That hasn't been effective in terms of doing that. And so now we see today, the market opened up, went down about 1,000, I think 1,100 points, almost hit the stop trading downside of minus 7%. It went down to minus 6%. Then it came up to only being down a little over 100 points. Now it is falling again. They're not able to sustain this. It is now down 415 points, according to the Drudge Report. Well, stay with us when we come back. We're going to have more news. The TSA is giving us the illusion of safety. How many times are we going to give up our freedom? How many times are we going to think we can buy safety by giving up our freedom and our privacy? Are we going to do it even at the movie theaters? Stay with us. We'll be right back. We talked earlier in the show about the amazing statement by our Secretary of the Treasury, Jack Lew, talking about China. Last month, July 8th, he went to the Hutchins Center on Fiscal and Monetary Policy, and he talked to the Brookings Institute, and he had this to say about China, saying that China, really, we were separated from their markets. They really didn't have any effect on us. Really? Yeah, you know, China is just kind of this little island that doesn't really engage with the rest of the world, according to the guy who is our Treasury Secretary in the Obama administration. Here's what he had to say.
But I will say that China's markets are still pretty much separated from world markets. They're obviously moving towards being more integrated, but right now they're not. So you're not going to, I don't think...
China's not integrated.
The direct linkage there. I think the concern that is a real one is, what does it mean about long-term growth in China?
Yeah, this guy has been he's a lawyer. He's been a party apparatchik. That's why he's where he is. He doesn't have any experience in economics. He doesn't have any experience in business. And how can you be any more clueless than Clueless Lou? But here's what he has to say about Hillary Clinton's emails. Of course, he weighed in on that just to show you, just to underscore the fact that this guy is there not because he knows anything about economics or business, but because he is a political hack. Here's what he said about Hillary Clinton's emails.
I mean, President Obama has indicated this is going to be one of the most open and transparent governments we've ever seen. And as one of his representatives, I would ask that you actually respond to the question, which is, did you ever notice that you were corresponding with Secretary Clinton on an account that was not a .gov account?
Congressman, I always...
Did you ever notice that, yes or no?
I always made sure I was corresponding with the right person.
You're very good at this, not answering questions, and I appreciate the way you tap dance, but I think everyone in the room understands my question, and you're just not answering it. Did you know that you were corresponding with Secretary Clinton on an account that was not a .gov account? Yes or no?
Congressman, I don't remember giving it a lot of thought at the time.
Whether you give a lot of thought or not is not my question. The question is... Did you know you were corresponding with her on an email that was
It's a long time ago.
So you're saying you don't remember? Is that your testimony?
I'm just telling
you. Is it your testimony that you don't remember?
I'm just telling you that when I email people, I always make sure.
Is it fair to say you don't want to answer my question, Mr. Secretary? Because you know the question I'm asking, and you're refusing to answer it. So I guess what I'm assuming is you knew you were corresponding with her on an account that was a non-official account. And I understand you don't want to lie to Congress, and I appreciate that, and you don't want to be part of a news story. I appreciate that, so you don't want to answer my question. But I think all of us here understand that you're saying, I knew that it was a non-official account. I just don't want to tell you.
There you go. This guy was a party hack his entire life. He's 60 years old. After being nothing but a Democrat party hack, he gets a 2-year stint at Citibank at the very top. They hire him in at the very top, and of course, he can't remember. He won't say anything. That's why they put him in. Where they have him is because he's slippery, but he is absolutely clueless. Let's talk about those emails. This is a story from WeMeantWell.com. They say, as for any security Clinton may have used on her server, it's important to note that top secret materials within the government are not only processed on special hardware, they must be read inside of special rooms with physical security. Unclassified, classified up to secret, and TS/SCI are processed and retrieved on 3 distinct systems. Employees have separate logins for each system. You can't accidentally send a classified document to an unclassified address. So for Hillary or her colleagues to have gotten classified information into an unclassified system, they would have had to copy it or gist it into the class system while omitting the markings. Do you understand how deliberate this all is? When he says, I didn't notice if it had a .gov extension on it. It is far beyond that. He says, this is a deliberate decision to ignore law and regulations. If you then use a non-state server and your personal unencrypted phones, the likelihood of compromise is high. And I'll remind you of what Hillary Clinton said in the case of Chelsea Manning. Now, this was a guy that they've now sent to jail because he exposed the callous murder of innocent people from a distance, a video that showed that happening in Iraq. In December 2011, Chelsea Manning's court-martial was set to begin. None of the documents at issue in the prosecution was top secret, right? Unlike the documents found on Hillary Clinton's server. Manning didn't have any secret. But this is what she had to say. She said, we all have to be aware of the fact that some information is sensitive, which does not affect the security of individuals and relationships, deserves to be protected. We will continue to take the necessary steps to do so. Hillary Clinton. People are abandoning that rat's ship. Stay with us. After the break, we're going to be joined by Alex Jones. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. Alex will be coming up in 5 minutes. We've been talking about the market crash. We had Harry Dent joining us in the last hour, breaking down what he had predicted many times on this show. We've had many guests talking about the coming stock market. Alex will be joining us in 5 minutes. He'll be coming up. Right now, it's looking like the stock market rally in the middle of the day is actually a dead cat bounce. It came back to within 100 points after losing 1,000 points. If you look at this chart, it is straight down off the cliff, and then it kind of comes back up, and now it is trending back down. We're now down about 2.33% at the moment. As we were talking in the last segment, we were talking about Hillary Clinton, of course, and this legal issue that is coming up is something that a lot of people are abandoning that ship. Of course, this weekend we had Joe Biden meeting with Elizabeth Warren, someone that has not endorsed anyone in this race yet. I don't know if he's talking to her about becoming a running mate or if he's just looking to see if he can get her endorsement. We had Governor Jerry Brown saying that Biden ought to consider getting into the race. And we have this article from the New American saying the case against Hillary getting stronger. Her friends are scarce. They say while she may have many friends still in the State Department sticking with her, it appears that the list of powerful people who are willing to help her out of the jam is fairly thin. In fact, State Department officials may not be interested in helping their former boss as they are in covering their own hides, because this is something that is a major criminal operation. Of course, we've got Rupert Murdoch even saying that we need to get Mike Bloomberg in. I don't know if he's going to come in as a Democrat or what. We have Alex reporting in now live. We have him on the phone. I believe we made contact with him. Is that correct, guys? Okay, let's go to Alex Jones. Alex?
Absolutely, folks. Well, our predictions of this morning weren't hard to make and weren't hard to come true. I am here at Chicago O'Hare Airport preparing to board a plane to Austin, Texas here very, very soon, David. And I tell you, there's a little cocktail bar here beside me where a fellow's playing piano. Maybe we'll be able to hear some of that when he goes back to playing. And everybody's pretty much going on about their business, about the massive multi-thousand-point stock market drop we've seen in China, what we've seen here in the United States last week and now today, with them openly talking about halting trading. You've been covering all the latest on those fronts today, David. But the point is, this is an engineered bubble. This is being done to consolidate power on the bailouts that will then come, the rescue packages, that will simply transfer more power to the TPP, to the NAU, to the European Union. And it's our job to get the word out on this front for everybody. But we have that video that I know you guys are planning to air. I've been in the air, so I may have missed it, where the former Treasury Secretary promised and said, you know, under Obama, we're not connected to China. That's like saying a Siamese twin isn't connected to their brother or sister. That's like saying your head isn't attached to your shoulders or your neck. Oh, of course we're not connected to China, who's the majority private owner or government owner behind the Federal Reserve of our debt. We're not connected to China, but about 70% of our retail goods and drugs are manufactured there. We're not connected to China when we have about 10,000 people a week immigrating here legally and having their children here and having it paid for. We're not connected to China when most of our major pension funds and government funds and other investment slush funds are invested predominantly not in the United States, not even in India or Mexico, but in China. So this is like saying that a fish is not connected to the sea. This is how stupid they think we are in 2+2=5 land. But David, you've been there. It's just shocking to me. I remember after the crash in 2008, taking my son to play soccer. And it took people a week, and then finally they had all their newspapers out and were freaking out. But by then, the media was telling people what they should do to get things fixed, which was pay bailouts, turn over your rights, let them create more derivatives, sign government on legally to all derivatives in the future, and our journey towards balkanization, our journey towards total enslavement would then be complete. And so this is what we're talking about. This is the next phase. There'll be another phase after this, and yet another. But I believe we're only 5 to 10 years, depending on how they're able to push this, because they're not invincible. When I say that, they don't even know the time either, because they're running an agenda. But we are 5, 10, 12, maybe 15 years max out from them completing the next two rounds of their operations, David Knight. And so this is an absolute battle. Their plan is to cut off the resources. Their plan is to now schools in the U.S., as we show on InfoWars.com, are banning all flags. That was always the plan. Ban all literature, all culture, all names, all everything. Make it all evil, except whatever you regurgitate back from the media and the government. Only certified government sources are allowed to have comedy. Only certified government sources are allowed to say whatever they want. Only government-approved comedians can tell dirty jokes. Only, again, only governments can have symbols. Public can't videotape in public. You're not allowed to have language. You're not allowed to speak to people. Mom and dad are being banned. We're going to tell you how much salt you can have, but never warn you about GMOs, never warn you about vaccines. This is the great tyranny. They need to impoverish us. And again, from their perspective, 7.5 billion people set to go up to at least 9 billion, some estimates 11 billion, and then it'll peak in the next 30 years or so. The globalists believe we're an infestation, eating everything, killing everything, hurting everything. And from their perspective, you can see that. But regardless, if the public doesn't realize they've been seen as a mutagen, and if the elite have decided to play God and remove us, first by making us poor, then with forced inoculations, and other operations, then we're going to be here in 10 years with 1 in 3 with autism, not 1 in 58 from 1 in 25,000. This is their operation. And if we are so stupid, David, that they can hide this in plain view, we deserve what happens to us. So this is the amazing nature of what we face. The truth is, humans are beautiful. All of our inventions, all of our literature, all of our art, standing up for each other. The globalists had to make us ugly first and dumb us down first so that they could then be able to dominate and control us, because a free, virtuous people would never put up with what they've done. And so they are the authors of much of our downfall. They greased the skids. They laid the tracks to roll this train of dehumanization down the road. And they are the great arbiters. They are the will who put intent and consciousness into evil, intent and consciousness into oppressing and consolidating power. I mean, it's so insane to watch how they're able to do this time and time again, over and over again. But humanity is rising. Humanity is beginning to understand what's happening. David Knight, your response to that.
Well, yeah, Alex, exactly what you're saying. We've seen this happen over and over again. We've seen the crisis in Europe with the Greek banks. We've seen them push for that and say, well, the only way we're going to solve this is to have sovereignty turned over to the central government. We look at what happened in 2008. We saw the banks and major insurance companies getting massive bailouts of funds to keep them in business. And then they say, well, we repaid it all, but they repaid it with 0% loans.
That's right.
And they kept those at 0% in order to create this inflated stock market bubble. And then what did we get as reform? We got Dodd-Frank, which has done nothing but drive most of the small-sized banks out of business and make it virtually impossible for most people to get loans.
That's it. It's global domination. It's consolidation. It's financial warfare by the very people orchestrating it who were so arrogant. They admit that they're orchestrating it in their own books and publications, bragging to each other about the great job they've done for global governance and all the rest of it. But instead, all they've done is dumb down the brain trust of humanity. Instead, all they've done is maim themselves and us in the process. And it's just absolutely imperative that the globalists start being honest about the fact that they believe they can build a breakaway civilization with the technocracy and the smartest people in the last 60 years, and that just like Hitler's plan one failed, their plan two has failed, and eugenics, as it's promoted and as it's pushed within their inner halls, needs to be abandoned. It needs to be dealt with, and we need to understand it is an inverted fraud. It is not eugenics to empower humanity. It is eugenics to wall off the mass of humanity and seal the world for the globalists. The problem is humans are too powerful in mass groups. Our actions, our desires can't be stopped. We are double and triple agents inside their operation, not even conscious most of the time, and our decisions are sabotaging everything they do. So their plan has failed because they haven't been able to reduce the population. They haven't been able. All they've done is maim the genetics of the planet, maim the genetics of humanity, maim the people that their daughters and sons are dating. The elites all know this. They all are starting to admit that all they've done is poison themselves. I mean, they were so foolish. The devil lied to them that they could have power and be God here and do all this to us when we're all interconnected. And that's why they have to realize, pull back now. You've been deceived. You've been set up, whether it's a subconscious drive towards annihilation and destruction, whether it's the devil, whatever you believe it is, it's here. And we're preaching and promoting liberty, enlightenment, and standing up to these people and not destroying the planet. But we are destroying the planet incrementally. The planet is being soft killed right now. And this latest consolidation is only part of that, accelerating the very policies that brought us to the point we are right now. But the truth is, humanity is beautiful. Humanity has strength. Humanity has a future. We just have to decide that we have that future. I mean, I'm right here in O'Hare. All this guy is playing, this black man's playing beautiful piano here with beautiful sunshine shining through, beautiful 70-degree day out there. And it's just so good to see humanity out here bustling around, getting things done, building a civilization, while these parasites who decided that we're the enemy perch on top of us and try to poison us to make us more manageable, and all it's done is backfired on them. So this is clearly the beginning of the next phase of the rout. If we expose the globalists are engineering it, they may be forced to back off. I'm about to board a plane to Austin, Texas. Lord willing, I'll be live tomorrow, 11 a.m. Central. The nightly news is tonight, 7 o'clock. David Knight, God bless you. Let's continue to track what's unfolding. Let's continue to go over all this information. Let's continue to try to alert everybody we can that they do matter. The decisions they make have great power. And again, thank you so much to everybody that had us down here in Canada. And thanks for the audience putting up with me being out of town. I'm going to be staying home for a long time now. And we shall return. But great job the crew there in Austin, Texas, and to all of our affiliates and sponsors. This is the beginning of open world government. All the signals, all the signs have been put out. Thank you, David Knight.
Thank you, Alex Jones. And that's Alex calling from the airport. He traveled to Toronto to speak this weekend. He had a speaking engagement there. He is on his way back to Austin. He will be back hosting the show tomorrow. If Alex was here, there is a story that I'm sure he would want to be talking about that he would be all over. It's one of the strangest things I've seen. It came out over this weekend. Satan worshipers dousing women with milk in a Planned Parenthood counter protest. So this is happening in Detroit and Ferndale, Michigan, at some Planned Parenthood locations. They have some Satanists clad in black robes, members of the Satanic Temple of Detroit, drenched women that were tied up. They drenched them with milk, simulating waterboarding, they said, to illustrate the theocratic agenda being imposed on female bodies. They are so twisted, I don't even understand the metaphor here. I mean, I guess there's some connection with don't force me to be a mother and breast milk and cow's milk. And, I don't know. These people are so far off the rails. It's just amazing. But isn't it amazing that just like here in Austin, it is always the satanic cult that shows up? I mean, Alex has talked about this over and over again, and it just keeps happening over and over again. They're the ones who show up and celebrate Planned Parenthood. Because as we've been pointing out for a very long time, abortion is, for many of these people, especially the Satanists, it is a right. And I'm not talking about R-I-G-H-T, I'm talking about R-I-T-E. It is a religious right for these people. They celebrate it. They look at these videos, and even people who have supported abortion in the past are absolutely outraged at these videos, seeing the trafficking in human body parts, the pushing to get people to have an abortion because they want to make money off of it, then chopping up these babies' parts and selling them off. Everybody else is appalled at this, but not the Satanists. They come out and they pour milk on women as a counter demonstration. How twisted. How twisted can you get? Absolutely amazing. Now, just before Alex joined us, we were talking about how things are starting to change, how Hillary's friends, those particular rats, are jumping that particular ship. And, of course, a lot of people are looking out for themselves there in the State Department who are trying to push back on this, not because they're trying to support Hillary, but because they're trying to push back on this. Will she go to jail? I certainly don't think so. And the Clintons seem to be able to get away with crime after crime after crime. But this may be, in my opinion, a sign that the establishment does not want her, that the Democrats want to push her out. Always a bridesmaid. Never a bride, unfortunately, for Hillary. She's kind of been the stalking horse for Obama. And who will she be the stalking horse for this time? Joe Biden, as I pointed out, met with Elizabeth Biden over the weekend, getting encouraging remarks from Governor Jerry Brown in California and other Democrats. We got Governor O'Malley saying she is the past. We need to not get tied up in the past and the problems of the past. Clearly talking about her, saying we need to have debates, which she is standing in opposition to. And then we have this interesting thing from Rupert Murdoch, the guy that owns Fox News. He tweeted this out. He said, with Trump becoming a very serious candidate, it's time for next billionaire candidate Mike Bloomberg to step into the ring. Greatest mayor. You hear that? You hear that? The guy that owns conservative Fox News. The guy that owns Republican-leaning Fox News said Mike Bloomberg is the greatest mayor. He wasn't the greatest mayor. He was America's greatest nanny. You know, Megyn Kelly famously said, and we pointed out the fact that Rupert Murdoch's son is heavily involved with big pharmaceutical companies when they were pushing mandatory vaccines. She said, well, is it Big Brother? Yes, it's Big Brother, but sometimes you need Big Brother, said Megyn Kelly. Yeah, sometimes, like when the Murdoch family is involved in pharmaceutical industry, when Fox News, like most of mainstream media, gets 70% of its advertising revenue from big pharmaceuticals. So now you got Rupert Murdoch pushing Mike Bloomberg. I don't know if he thinks he's going to come in as a Republican or as a Democrat. I mean, it wasn't long ago that people were pushing Mike Bloomberg to be mayor of London. Because, you know, hey, if you're a billionaire, you just need to be able to go wherever you want. It doesn't even matter if you're not even a citizen of the UK. Make him mayor of London. And now we can get him to become president of the United States because his qualification is he's a billionaire. And he's a great mayor, according to Rupert Murdoch. This is a guy who has single-handedly outspent the NRA in, was it Washington? I believe it was Washington. Was it Washington or Oregon? One of the northwestern states pushing for regulation. This is a guy who is hardcore against the Constitution, hardcore against the Second Amendment, an incredible purveyor of the nanny state. He has never seen a freedom that he doesn't think he should regulate out of existence. And Rupert Murdoch comes back after a lot of pushback. He says, I didn't say I would vote for him. Just a friend that I admire. Yeah, a friend. Highly placed friend in Fox News. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We were just joined by Alex Jones reporting from the airport. He spoke in Toronto this weekend. He will be back tomorrow hosting the show. And of course, the big news today is what's happening in the stock market. I'm sure you've heard about the massive drop-off this morning. We saw a midday rally where it came back to within 100 points, about 1% down. It had dropped down about 6% earlier in the day, 1,100 points. It has now gone back down after that midday rally. It is now down to 549 points negative. And down 3.34% at the moment as we speak. This is something that, as our guest earlier in the show, Harry Dent, pointed out, we've had a stock market bubble because there are no fundamentals to support this. This isn't something that is just bad management in China. Yes, China has inflated this. Yes, the United States has inflated this with its Federal Reserve policies. Propping up the stock market. And that's what we see happening probably today, the plunge protection team trying to keep this from going any farther. It came very close to having all trading suspended. That happens at a minus 7% rate. We had gotten over 6%, so it got very close to suspending trading. Of course, in China, they did suspend trading for 80% of the stocks. Once they have a certain percentage fall off, they stop trading on those stocks. 80% of the stocks were stopped from trading today in China. That's how far it fell, how quickly it fell. China down 11% last week, down 9% today at the close of the market. $143 billion that the Chinese government has put in over the last couple of months has now vanished. That's what happens when governments try to control this. Nevertheless, we have Bernie Sanders coming in and saying what we're seeing here is unfettered free trade. No, we're seeing the failure of government manipulation. They can suspend reality, but sooner or later, the coyote, after he runs off the cliff, looks down and sees that there's nothing underneath him. And we're at that moment right now. An article on Infowars.com, global trade and free fall. Container freight rates from Asia to Europe crash 60% in 3 weeks. You see, that's the fundamental basis of the problem that we're seeing here. The fact that the economic activity is down. We've seen oil stocks tanking, oil prices tanking for the last year. Why? Because demand has fallen so much. The economy globally is falling. When we see depression coming, we also have to worry about a possible war. And we see the government ramping up war both externally as well as trying to create a war, provoke a war internally. They're trying to provoke a war with Russia. They're trying to provoke a war internally with Balkanization, with massive immigration, with massive ramping up of the welfare state, bringing all of the immigrants that they're enticing to come in, that they're paying to come in, trying to increase that welfare state. At the same time, we've now got the presidential race. We've got Rupert Murdoch saying we need to get Michael Bloomberg to enter the race. His sole qualification, I guess, is because, as Rupert Murdoch said, he was the best mayor ever. This is a guy who thought he should ban soft drinks for you. The guy who wants to take away your guns while he keeps himself guarded with an army of private soldiers, mercenaries to guard him, bodyguards. This is someone who has absolutely no respect for the rule of law, and neither does Rupert Murdoch. People on his conservative Fox News calling for forced vaccinations, taking away your informed consent. If you take away people's informed consent, as we say over and over again, you are nothing but a slave. They treat you like a slave. And we can see this now. We see yet another case. We have a report on Infowars.com. Hendra virus vaccine owners say vaccine killed healthy horses. We've got a case out of Reno County in Kansas. We got 70 school children, all who have been vaccinated. Talk about herd immunity. No, they were all vaccinated. They all came down with whooping cough. Join us again tomorrow. Alex Jones will be hosting.